In this standard, we evaluate the role of Georgia in the modern civil rights movement. The 1940s and 50s saw a major push by blacks to fight segregation and reclaim civil rights that were denied them during the Jim Crow era. While the civil rights movement began the moment the southern states passed the Jim Crow laws, the 1940s and 50s were a time of organized and usually peaceful resistance that helped to ultimately end these laws. Blacks who were returning home from World War II began to push for civil rights as they had served our country well. Based on their role in the war, President Harry Truman desegregated the armed forces. Nationally, organizations such as the NAACP went to court to combat unjust segregation laws and won many of the cases. In turn, leaders such as Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and John Lewis of Georgia focused on ending segregation with the use of economic boycotts similar to the Montgomery bus boycott of 1954. In Standard A, we explain Georgia's response to Brown versus Board of Education, including the 1956 flag and Assembly Commission. In 1954, Georgia's response to the Supreme Court decision in Brown versus Board of Education was purposeful and intense. Brown versus Board of Education overturned the 1896 Plessy versus Ferguson ruling that had allowed for legal segregation. Segregationist politicians wanted to continue Jim Crow laws in the state. They were not happy upon hearing the court's 9-0 decision that racial segregation violated the 14th Amendment, and they were determined that Georgia schools would not integrate. In 1956, to show contempt towards Supreme Court decisions such as Brown versus Board of Education, Georgia's legislators voted to change the state flag to incorporate the Confederate battle flag. The state constitution provided the legislature the sole authority to change the flag, so no public referendum was necessary to make the change. While legislators denied that the change in flag design was an overt display of opposition to desegregation, the new flag design was almost certainly racially motivated. During the height of the civil rights movement in the late 1960s, some people were already making suggestions to return to the pre-1956 flag. By the 1980s, legislative sessions considered restoring the pre-1956 flag. Sentiment for keeping the 1956 flag with its battle flag emblem was stronger than the state legislators anticipated. For instance, in 1993, Governor Zell Miller's attempt to change the flag almost cost him re-election. Even the impending 1996 Atlanta Olympic Games and Atlanta business leaders were unable to persuade the General Assembly to change the flag. Finally, Governor Roy Barnes attempted to put the issue of the 1956 flag to rest. Before coalitions could be organized to slow or stop the change of the flag, Barnes encouraged the legislature to pass House Bill 16. After it was passed and a new flag design was revealed, supporters of the 1956 flag were livid, with some calling the new flag the Barnes rag. This led to the upset victory of Sonny Perdue over Barnes in 2002. By 2004, citizens of Georgia voted to choose the current state flag over the Barnes flag. Going back to the Brown versus Board of Education ruling and concerning the integration of the public schools, the Georgia General Assembly supported massive resistance to go against the new ruling. By 1960, however, federal mandates were strongly encouraging Georgia to desegregate, and Governor Ernest Vandiver asked the citizens of the state to render their input regarding the controversy via the Sibley Commission. John Sibley was a segregationist lawyer who also believed resistance to federal mandates was useless. John Sibley led 10 hearings, known as the Sibley Commission, across the state to determine if the people felt that they should continue to resist the federal government or change laws to integrate schools. Personally, he believed the best plan was to allow integration on a very small scale. After the sessions were conducted, 60% of Georgians claimed that they would rather close the public schools rather than integrate. Despite the findings, Sibley pushed for schools in Georgia to desegregate on a limited basis. Based on the commission's findings, the legislature was set to vote on the matter in January of 1961, but the integration of the University of Georgia shifted the governor's and legislature's focus. After attempting to close the University of Georgia, only to be overruled by a federal judge, Governor Vanver gave in and asked the General Assembly to accept Sibley's recommendations. Later that year, the city of Atlanta desegregated its schools. In Standard B, we described the role of individuals such as Martin Luther King Jr. and John Lewis, groups such as the SNCC and SCLC, and events such as the Albany Movement and March on Washington in the Civil Rights Movement. Essential to the success of the Civil Rights Movement was leadership, and Georgians Martin Luther King Jr. and John Lewis were at the forefront. Martin Luther King Jr.'s work and devotion to nonviolent protest earned him the Nobel Peace Prize and led to the national holiday created in his honor. As the son and grandson of ministers, King eventually chose the same profession. He earned his Ph.D. in Divinity from Boston University, where he met his wife, Coretta Scott. In 1954, King moved to Montgomery, Alabama to lead a church. A year later, he found himself serving as the spokesperson for the successful Montgomery bus boycott. Eventually, the Supreme Court made segregation on Montgomery buses unconstitutional. After the successful boycott, King, along with other civil rights groups, attempted a similar action in Albany, Georgia, that was considered less successful. Martin Luther King Jr. enjoyed brilliant victories such as the March on Washington, his creation of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, SCLC, his voter registration campaign in Selma, Alabama, which ultimately led to the Voting Rights Act of 1965, and winning the Nobel Peace Prize. King was instrumental in ending segregation and changing America's views on race and racial equality. Unfortunately, while he did not live to see the fruits of his labor, his efforts and leadership have led us to an America where some of the ideals from his I Have a Dream speech have been met. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. is the only Black to have a federal holiday named in his honor. Also, he is the only Black and non-president to have a memorial created in his honor on the National Mall in Washington, D.C. John Lewis was born to sharecroppers in Pike County, Alabama. Like King, Lewis became an integral part of Georgia's history through his leadership in the Civil Rights Movement. He was active in the 1960s sit-ins to protest Jim Crow laws, participated in the Freedom Rides of the early 1960s, became the chair of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC, and was a keynote speaker at the 1963 March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom. In 1965, Lewis led over 600 marchers across the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma, Alabama, only to be beaten by Alabama state troopers. Television coverage of this Bloody Sunday event brought much-needed attention to the civil rights movement. In the late 1960s and 70s, Lewis continued his dedication to seeking civil rights through voter registration and volunteer programs. He was elected to the Atlanta City Council in 1981 and advocated for ethics in government and community preservation. In November of 1986, Lewis was elected to the United States Congress, where he continues to serve today. Lewis has won numerous awards through the years that reflect his dedication to seeking civil rights for all. The Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC, was one of the major civil rights organizations of the 1960s. It was a national organization formed in North Carolina, focused on orchestrating peaceful nonviolent protests. The group, made up of high school and college-age students, became known for sit-ins, Freedom Rides, and the Freedom Summer in Mississippi. In Georgia, the group began its focus on the cities of Albany and Atlanta. The Southern Christian Leadership Conference, SCLC, was created in 1957 in Montgomery, Alabama, in reaction to the Montgomery bus boycott. It was led by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who was living in Montgomery at the time. The headquarters for the SCLC was moved to Atlanta. Filing class action lawsuits against the federal government for sustaining segregated employee cafeterias, the SCLC planned rallies, marches, and boycotts to end such scenarios. The SCLC organized protests, the Albany Movement, for instance, and opportunities for the economic improvement of Blacks throughout the South. The SCLC continues to strive to change and impact lives today. Never forgetting its original goal of civil rights equality, the SELC today focuses on causes such as health care, prison reform, fair treatment of refugees, and job site safety. After the success of the Montgomery bus boycott in 1955, civil rights leaders in other southern cities sought to challenge the segregation laws. One of the cities selected was Albany in southwest Georgia. Starting in the fall of 1961, members of SNCC and the local community began to protest the segregationist policies of the city. It started out by sitting in the whites-only waiting room at the city's bus station. Massive resistance from whites and the police department led to over 500 protesters landing in jail. However, unlike Montgomery, many of Albany's black middle class did not initially support the protests. In turn, Police Chief Laurie Pritchett used nonviolent tactics to arrest but not harm the protesters. To draw more national attention to the cause, the SNCC invited Martin Luther King Jr. to take part in the protest. Though arrested many times, King was released from jail almost immediately. Chief Pritchett also made sure he had enough room to imprison all the protesters and work with other counties to send the demonstrators to their jails as well. In the end, most of the protesters were jailed, leaving very few to protest. By the summer of 1962, King viewed the Albany movement as a failed attempt to desegregate an entire community, but he saw it also as a valuable learning experience. He used what he learned, including the power of protest songs, in his successful Birmingham campaigns. In 1963, over 250,000 civil rights activists gathered in Washington, D.C. to promote their cause and push for civil rights legislation. During the March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom, Martin Luther King Jr. gave what is arguably his most famous speech, "I Have a Dream." The March on Washington encouraged the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act of 1965 and made King the most well-known spokesperson of the civil rights movement. Throughout the 1960s, civil rights activists for the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC, and the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, SCLC, continued to target Georgia. In 1963, Savannah became one of the most integrated cities in the South due to the efforts of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, the NAACP. Soon after, Atlanta Mayor Ivan Allen Jr., Coca-Cola President Robert Woodruff, and other business leaders worked with civil rights leaders to ensure that Atlanta desegregated peacefully. In the 1970s, Governor Jimmy Carter called for an end to discrimination in Georgia, and blacks such as Maynard Jackson and Andrew Young were elected to high political office. Still, Georgia was slow to change its segregationist policies, especially in the rural areas of the state. In Standard C, we explain the resistance to the 1964 Civil Rights Act, emphasizing the role of Lester Maddox. Encouraged by the March on Washington, the U.S. Congress passed the Civil Rights Act of 1964, which was signed into law by President Lyndon B. Johnson. The Civil Rights Act of 1964 forbade discrimination based on sex and race in hiring, promoting, and firing. Southern congressional Democrats, led by Senator Richard Russell, strongly opposed the passage of the legislation. Some segregationists were determined to ignore the new law and responded with physical violence. However, most Southerners accepted the controversial passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 without resorting to violence. It was during this period of great social and political change in Georgia that future governor Lester Maddox gained notoriety for his strong, unshakable segregationist stand. Born in Atlanta in 1915, Maddox dropped out of high school and he worked several jobs, including the Bell Bomber factory during World War II. In 1947, he opened the Pickrick Cafeteria near the campus of Georgia Tech, which was open only to white customers. Maddox refused to serve blacks and anyone who suggested integration. His restaurant featured segregationist literature and a wishing well labeled "Make a Wish for Segregation." He gained fame throughout Georgia due to his advertisements for the restaurant that he placed in the Atlanta Journal newspaper. His open defiance of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 cost him national exposure, as well as the time when he chased three blacks out of his restaurant with a gun. Later, he was known throughout the nation for his use of axe handles, which he used to forcibly remove blacks who tried to integrate his restaurant. These were known as Pickwick drumsticks. When the courts upheld the Civil Rights Act, Maddox was found in contempt of court due to his refusal to serve blacks. Being fined $200 per day, 2 months later, he closed the cafeteria rather than allow it to be integrated. Maddox's initial entry into politics was met with defeat. In the late 1950s and early 1960s, he ran two unsuccessful campaigns for mayor of Atlanta, losing to William B. Hartsfield and Ivan Allen Jr. He also ran for lieutenant governor in 1962, losing to another segregationist candidate in the Democratic primary. However, in 1966, Maddox surprised many by beating Ellis Arnall for governor in the Democratic primary and then going on to be elected as governor of the state. As the last overtly segregationist governor in the state's history, it is ironic that Maddox appointed more blacks to government positions than all prior Georgia governors combined. He also received support of both whites and blacks alike due to his Little People days, in which twice a month, average people could stand in line to meet with the governor. Nonetheless, Maddox was criticized for not allowing flags at state buildings to be flown at half-mast after the death of Martin Luther King Jr., and for his fight against the civil rights platform of the Democratic Party at their 1968 National Convention. After his term as governor was over due to constitutional term limits, Maddox ran for lieutenant governor. As Governor Jimmy Carter's lieutenant governor, he often clashed with Carter over many issues. Maddox ran for governor again in 1974, but was defeated. He also ran for U.S. president in 1976. After retiring from politics, he operated several other businesses, but none were as profitable as the Pickwick Cafeteria. Throughout his life, he never apologized for his defense of segregation. Maddox died of cancer at the age of 87.